chili.
Good morning, everyone. It's a little bit crazy here this morning. My lovely wife isn't with us today. She's away, and so I'm kind of like trying to do things with one hand tied behind your back. It's crazy how much I miss her when she's not here. And but it is good. And happy Father's Day to all of those fathers who are here today. I'm going to get right to it with our announcements this morning. Our ministry of the month continues to be Crandall University. We invite you to pray and to support Crandall as you are able. We've had a great visit from Dr. Robert Knowles at the end of last month to kind of lead us into this month of supporting them, and so I really look forward to seeing more of what God is doing there. There will be a prayer meeting this week, again, not June 13th, but this week at 7 p.m. on Zoom. I will send out the link for that in my email tomorrow morning. Beginning June 5th, we started with the blessing table at the back in the entryway or the foyer. Anything on that table is yours for the taking. We're sharing what we have with one another. So if you have something that you have made that you want to share with others, you can put it on the table. I see there's some scrubbies back there. There's some all kinds of stuff, actually. So last week there were cookies. I can attest to the quality of cookies that we have here. Thank you for those. So share things, take things. It works best when we do both. When, you know, don't feel shy about taking something that's on that table. The person who put it there wants you to take it. So please, take something. 12 Baskets Food Bank this month. We are looking for canned tomatoes. We're looking for table salt and store-bought jam. If you can remember, if possible, to pick up those things when you're shopping. If you see some sales, grab some stuff. It certainly is a help, and they definitely need these things. I just want to put out, we also have our Bible study on Tuesday night this week. We've missed a couple of weeks of Bible study, so we got some catching up to do. We're still dealing with Pentecost and Bible study, so we're going to be looking at Acts chapter 2 this week in Bible study, so I invite you to join us at our home if you're able. We're going to have a church family coffee time next Saturday, June 25th, and this has been a long time coming, and we decided that we wanted to go ahead and do this. So next Saturday morning from 9:30 to 11:30, pop in, have a coffee. There'll be some treats, I'm sure, but more than that, just come in and spend some time seeing one another and being in the same space together. I'll have the windows open, and we'll have some coffee together and enjoy some fellowship. So next Saturday morning from 9:30 to 11:30, I will put out email reminders as well. Darlene has it in the letter that's going out this week. So we know about it. It's really for the church family. So hopefully you're free and able to attend on Saturday morning. I want to put a mention out there that we do have a semi-annual meeting coming up in July, and it will be on July 31st, and I have not selected a snow date for that. I'm going to just go on faith that I probably shouldn't have said that, right? But, and we want to invite you to keep the ADBA in your prayers. We have had someone step up already and volunteer to be our liaison person. And so this is almost a moot comment, but I left it as an announcement because I want you to know how quickly this has been dealt with. And Linda has offered to be our liaison person as she continues to serve in the role of church clerk. There is some logistical advantages to that, but she will be our liaison person for the ADBA, and I'm excited to see where God is leading in that. But I do invite you to keep the ADBA in your prayers as we continue to work there to see where God is leading us there also. This week there's no new Compass question for you this week, but please feel free, if you've still got the list of questions, to look at them. If you haven't sent me any thoughts on that stuff yet, to reflect on those questions and send your thoughts. There's no real cutoff date on this, but I do look forward to hearing from you on those things. So Leon is going to be doing the call to worship this morning and the prayer of invocation, so I'll invite Leon to come forward at this time.
Morning. Our relationship with our fathers are complicated. For some of us, our father's love is like God's love, too deep, too long, too wide, too strong to measure. Some of our dads are here, some were never here. For some of us, God's love fills us in the empty spaces our fathers left behind. All of us are shaped by relationships or lack of relationships with our fathers. On this day, when we remember what it means to have a father or be a father, we recognize the importance of fathers in our communities. We pledge as a congregation to love and nurture the fathers among us so that they will manifest the love of God in all that they do. Let us pray. Loving God, you who are our father and our mother, we thank you that you have shown us how important it is to follow your example as we grow in faith. Teach us to be obedient to your will, respecting you as children ought. Thank you for your mercy despite our disobedience. Strengthen us to stand up against the challenges of this world, honoring your name and trusting your grace. In the name of your Son, we pray. Amen.
Thank you. I'd like to invite you to stand with me as we sing our first hymn this morning, This Is My Father's World. Please rise. time for our offerings this morning, which you have been continuing to place in the plates at the entryways. Thank you for that. And let's just bow in prayer. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we are so blessed, Lord, to be yours and to be able to come together today, Lord, in praise of you and in thanks to Christ Jesus. Lord God, we ask that you guide us and lead us today. We ask that you bless these, our offerings, Lord. May they be used, God, in a way that brings you glory, that is befitting for your love for this place and those whom you have placed around us. We ask this today in confidence of our Father's love. Amen. So we have a couple of praise songs for you this morning. We're going to begin with How Deep the Father's Love for Us. Paid my ransom.
God, we praise you and thank you. We praise you and thank you for the wounds of Christ that have freed us, God. Lord, Father, we are so thankful for Christ Jesus. Amen.
I just realized what I forgot, Bonnie. I had that moment where I was distracted by something else and I didn't bring over the microphone for you all. Which I know you two would be just fine with no one hearing your beautiful prayers, but we just can't have that. So I'm just gonna give it to you like this, actually.
You are
adaptable. I'm gonna give it to you to hold. That would be better for today. I know, microphones are frightening things. They are frightening things. So we're going to enter into our time for communion this morning, joining together in obedience of our Lord's command to share in the Lord's Supper. We do this not because we must, but because we may. We do this because of our love and our devotion to Jesus. As we prepare to take in our communion today, I want you to be reminded that this is something special, something sacred, something passed down for centuries. This is for all disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ who have confessed their sins before Him and who have professed Him, their Lord and their Savior. This is the Lord's table for the blessing and the fellowship of all disciples. So, our Lord Jesus, on the night when He was betrayed, He took a loaf of bread. And after He had given thanks, He broke it and He said, "This is My body given for you. Do this in remembrance of Me." So as we join together in this time of remembrance, let us also give thanks for this bread. So Darlene, will you please offer a prayer of thanks for the bread?
As we take this bread, representing Your life that was broken for us, we remember Your faithfulness to all who will receive You. We can't begin to know Your suffering on the cross, yet You took that pain for us. As You instructed Your disciples, we too receive this bread in remembrance of You.
Amen. Thank you, Darlene. So let us now eat of this bread in remembrance of Christ's sacrifice for us. In the same way that evening, after supper, Jesus took His cup, and He said, "This cup is a new covenant in My blood." He said, "Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of Me." So now, as often as we eat of the bread and drink of the cup, we proclaim Christ's death until He comes. So Bonnie, I'd like to ask you to offer a prayer for our cup today.
Holy Father, help us focus on these symbols. Help us recall Your word, telling us to remember and give thanks. Remember how Jesus is the only name under heaven by which we must be saved. Remember that His shed blood saved the ones beside Him on the cross, just like He saves us. Thank You, Father, for this cup, for Your only Son, and the one way He provides to heal our brokenness In his name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Drink this in remembrance of Christ's blood that was shed for you, and be thankful. Heavenly Father, we are so very thankful for you and for our Savior Jesus and for Holy Spirit that guides and leads us. Lord God, we ask that you be with us today. Help us, Father, to remember your love for us given through Christ. May this guide us in our thoughts and our words and our actions, Lord, in every day. In Christ Jesus' holy name, amen. Thank you for the prayers, ladies. So we have another hymn this morning, You Are My All and All, number 583. Please rise.
Strength when I am weak.
First and foremost, fully and completely inspired by Deuteronomy 6:4-9. Listen, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone.
We must love the Lord our God with all our heart, all our soul, and all our strength.
And you must commit yourselves wholeheartedly to these commands.
We shall repeat them again and again to our children. Talk about them when we are at home, when we are on the road, when we are going to bed, and when getting up.
Yes, tie those words to your hands and wear them on your forehead as reminders. Write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. Never forget to love the Lord first and foremost, fully and completely.
We will love the Lord our God with all our heart, all our soul, and all our strength.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Leon. I slid the fully in completely in the title of that just because I'm a bit of a tragically hip fan. Some of you will get that, some of you won't, but that's all right. Let's sing a song. I was going to pray, but no, we get to sing.
Father's Day, I'm digging out all the good father songs. This one's called Good Good Father.
Stories of what they think you.
Thank you, praise team. Well, let's pray. Heavenly Father, creator, sustainer, lover of sinners, God, you are so good to us, and we are so very thankful. Lord, we look around and we see the beauty of creation, especially this time of year, God. It is so obvious. Your hand is at work around us. It's so obvious, God, that you have a plan and a purpose. Lord, as we bow before you today, we ask that you guide us and you help us to see your plan and your purpose. Help us to join you, God, as you work in our midst, as you work in us and through us, God. Lord, we pray for your blessing to be upon this church and this community. We ask, God, that you help us to make you known, to glorify you through our actions, Lord. May you give us beautiful feet that take your beautiful words to those around us. Lord, we think of those who are going through struggles today, who are either dealing with illness or difficulty. And God, we ask that you be with them. God, especially for our friends who are dealing with age-related things. Lord, it is so hard to see our friends face those troubles. And Lord, we just ask that you be with them and bless them. And Lord, for those folks who have received diagnosis recently and are uncertain of a path forward, we pray for you to bring them peace and for you to give wisdom to those folks whom they are working with, that they can lead them in a way, God, that is right and proper for them in this stage of their lives. And Lord, we ask for you to be with those who aren't here today for other reasons. Busyness, family commitments, whatever it may be. Lord, may they feel our prayers for them. May they know that they are missed. May they desire, God, to be among us soon again. And may you make that possible for them. Lord God, we are so very thankful for you, for your word, for all that you have given us, that we may know you, God, and may take confidence in who you are and how you love us. Father, we cherish you. And we ask that you continue to bless us and lead us. In Christ Jesus' holy name, amen. So it is Father's Day. I love being a dad. Being a dad's a great thing, but I had no idea how much I would love being a grandfather. I cherish the opportunity to be a dad to my children, and I'm so thankful to God for it, but I might have been built to be a grandfather. Like, the joy that I get from those kids is just tremendous. And my dad was a little bit like me in that he really cherished his role as grandfather, and I have a big family, so he had many more grandchildren than I did. They called him Grampy Jerry. He even had a leather belt with Grampy Jerry stamped in it that he wore with great pride for far too many years, I believe. So my dad was Jerry Milne, and Jerry was a car salesman his whole life. He worked at different dealerships, almost every Ford dealership in the valley he worked at some point in time. Some of you may have bought a car from him, and if you did, if Dad were still here today, he probably would remember what car he sold you. He may not remember your name, but he would remember that he sold you a Monarch in 1982. That's just the way his brain worked. He made connections. He loved knowing who people were and making connections with people. Dad would be 90 years old, nearly 90 years old, were he with us today. Dad passed away about 9 years ago now. Dad raised seven children with my mother. There are five older kids in my family. So they had five kids who, the oldest was about, I think, 18, and the youngest was about 11 when I came along. Surprise! And then they were so gracious and loving, they gave me a little brother that I could torment and play with. So there are seven kids in my family. And so my younger brother and I, we had actually a completely different experience with our parents than my older siblings did, because my older siblings had the joy of knocking off all the sharp edges, right? So by the time we got to them, they were wore down and tired. So we pretty well had it, we had it pretty good, right? Sadly, my mom died when I was 7 years old. Dad was 44 years old, had five children who were in their teens, and he had two sons that were 5 and 7 when he became a widow. And much of my love and respect for that man comes from those years and how he walked that difficult path. And he had lots of help. We had so many people who, like, I have people who I called Grammy and Grampy who are no relation to me whatsoever. And I had a number of people who were like that, that, you know, we would go to Grammy and Grampy Kinsman's, or we would go here or there, and they just stepped in and looked after us. And they did that out of love, and I'm so thankful for it. Dad did not do these things alone. And Dad, he was not perfect by any means. And late in his life, he and I were able to have some really frank conversations about forgiveness for both of us, for things that we had done together, and it was, those were hard, tear-filled conversations. But I'm so thankful that we had them. Dad loved scouting. That was one of his joys, was being a scouter. Back then, it was just young men, boys, and cubs who were young boys. And Dad did a lot of that over many years. And we used to go on these big adventures. He loved big adventures. And one of my favorite trips we used to do was a trip to Maitland to a place called the Bat Caves. So we would take a busload of kids, and we would go down to Maitland, and then we would park the bus in a gravel pit, and we had to hike to where the Bat Caves were. And if you've ever been there, there's a bit of a brook that in the spring is a bit more like a river that you have to traverse to get across to get to the caves. And the first time we went there, I think Dad was expecting a brook, and it was a river. And we had some things that we were able to work with. Being Boy Scouts, we were prepared. We had some ropes and some things like that. So Dad looked at me and he said, "Jeffrey," he says, I need you to strip down and cross that river and so that we can make a bosun's chair and get everyone across." And I looked at him and I said, "No darn way." No, I didn't actually say that. I thought it, because that water's cold, but I didn't actually say it because I love my dad and I love my life. And so I didn't say those words. I reluctantly got into the river and went across, and we made the bosun's chair, and it was one of the best adventures that we had together in you know, getting those 30 some people across that river safely. It was awesome. I may still suffer the effects of hypothermia, but that was okay. But as a dad, he loved us who we were. He challenged us to be something better. And he was very faithful. And in his later years, what I love about Dad is he was ever changing and evolving. Dad was baptized in his 70s, a believer's baptism. We were kind of early in life, part of the United Church tradition. And he joined a Baptist church and got baptized in his 70s. Praise God, I was there that day to be with him. That's some of my backstory of my dad and my experience. And I pray that my kids feel the same way about me as I feel about my dad. Certainly left me with some of the very best things that I love about myself. I can tie back to him. Now today we're going to look at a passage of scripture from Genesis. And it's a passage that deals with Abraham and Isaac. We're going to look at Genesis chapter 22. And I got to give you a little backstory to this before we go into it, because if we go into it without understanding some of the context, we're going to miss some of the really important things here. This is the story of God asking Abraham to sacrifice his one and only son. Now, many of you are familiar with the story. Genesis 22 follows on the heels of Genesis 21, of course, and in that, that's the chapter where Abraham's legitimate son, Ishmael, is sent away with his mother, Hagar. See, what had happened was God had called Abraham away from his familiar land to a new place, and Abraham followed him and gave God surrounded him with people, but not a son. And God had promised Abraham that he would be the father of a great many. And he's old, and his wife is old. And it seems pretty darned unlikely that this is going to happen. So Abraham's wife, Sarah, offers her handmaid to basically become a wife to Abraham and provide him an heir. And this happens. Abraham has a son with Hagar. This is Ishmael. And in doing this, what happened is Sarah basically took hold of the situation, gave her husband an heir, as God had promised, but this wasn't the heir that God had promised. And if you remember last week when we were looking at Nehemiah, I said one of the great things about Nehemiah was the way that he embraced what God was trying to do, and he was willing to slow things down and trust that God's plan and purpose was going to be fulfilled, and he basically said we're going to work at half speed in order to make sure that what God has said we can do will be done. Well, here in this story, they didn't have the relationship yet that gave them the kind of trust that they needed in God. And they took hold of the situation themselves. And this resulted in a really troubling situation, because when God finally did give Abraham and Sarah a son, which he did do, and they were really old, just like he promised, now he's got two wives and two legitimate heirs. And things at home are pretty hard. And it's really difficult, because this isn't the way God had planned things to be. So what ends up happening, and this is a troubling part of the story, but what ends up happening is Hagar, the handmaid who becomes a wife, and her legitimate son Ishmael are sent away. Basically, this is divorcing them both. This is divorcing her in marriage, and this is removing Ishmael from his legitimate claim as an heir. And in doing so, it brings back the proper heir to be his sole son. Now, this story in chapter 21 ends well, because Hagar and Ishmael are heard by God. God blesses them and saves them, rescues them, and promises that Ishmael will be a leader or have many descendants that will become a great nation. So God ends up blessing them through that, even though what happened with them was not any of God's plan. None of that they asked for, none of it they asked for, and none of it did God desire, but God still stepped in, saved them both, and blessed them both. Now, that's the backstory to chapter 22. Here's chapter 22. Eventually, these pages are very thin. Chapter 22 reads, "Sometime later, God tested Abraham's faith. Abraham, God called. Yes, he replied. Here I am. Take your son, your only son, yes, Isaac, whom you love so much, and go to the land of Moriah. Go and sacrifice him as a burnt offering on one of the mountains which I will show you." The next morning, Abraham got up early, saddled his donkey, and took two of his servants with him, along with his son Isaac. Then he chopped wood for a fire for a burnt offering and set out for the place God had told him about. On the third day of their journey, Abraham looked up and saw the place in the distance. "Stay here with the donkey," Abraham told the servants. "The boy and I will travel a little farther. We will worship there, and then we will come right back." So Abraham placed the wood for the burnt offering on Isaac's shoulders, while he himself carried the fire and the knife. As the two of them walked on together, Isaac turned to Abraham and said, "Father." "Yes, my son," Abraham replied. "We have the fire and the wood," the boy said. "But where is the sheep for the burnt offering?" "God will provide a sheep of offering, my son," Abraham answered. And they both walked on together. When they arrived at the place where God had told him, Abraham built an altar and arranged the wood on it. Then he tied his son Isaac, and he laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Abraham picked up the knife to kill his son as a sacrifice. And at that moment, the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven, "Abraham, Abraham." "Yes," Abraham replied, "here I am." "Don't lay a hand on the boy," the angel said. "Don't hurt him in any way, for now I know that you truly fear God. You have not withheld from me even your son, your only son." Then Abraham looked up and saw a ram caught by its horns in the thicket. So he took the ram as a sacrifice and burnt offering in place of his son. Abraham named the place Yahweh Yair, which means "the Lord will provide." To this day, people still use that name as a proverb: "On the mountain of the Lord, it will be provided." Then the angel of the Lord called again to Abraham from heaven. "This is what the Lord says: because you have obeyed me and not withheld even your son, your only son, I swear by my own name that I will certainly bless you. I will multiply your descendants beyond number, like the stars in the sky and the sands on the seashore. Your descendants will conquer the cities of their enemies, and through your descendants, all the nations of the earth will be blessed, all because you have obeyed me." And they returned to the servants and traveled back to Beersheba, where Abraham continued to live. May God bless this reading of his word. In this story, I hope you notice that every time it mentioned Isaac, it said, "your only son." Emphasizing what has happened here. Emphasizing the value, not just that Abraham puts on this child, the value God has placed on this child. This is the heir God gave him. The heir God desired him to have. This was God's plan and purpose being worked out. Now, some commentators point out that child sacrifice was a thing back then. And it's true that there were some practices of child sacrifice. But I don't want you to be distracted by that, and I don't want you to let that diminish what God is calling Abraham to do here. Because a child sacrifice in that day, when it did happen, it happened when the child was newborn. And it happened either out of a desire to have a certain deity bless that family, or it happened out of a desire to have fertility. I don't quite understand it. It doesn't make sense to me why you would sacrifice a child for fertility, but hey, that's the way they saw it back then. And this wasn't in worship of Yahweh. This was for other deities, other lowercase g gods, okay? That was the practice back then. What God was calling Abraham to do was take his son, whom could walk, whom could talk, whom was probably already contributing a great deal to the family, take that son and sacrifice him. This was not something that was common. This was something completely out of the ordinary. This was something completely unusual. And Abraham certainly would have seen this as a very bizarre request from God. But Abraham is getting to know God, is what I believe is happening here. God tests him in this way. And I want you to pick up here on verse 5. When Abraham departs from his friends who are walking with him, he says to them, "Stay here with the donkey. The boy and I will travel a little farther. We will worship there, and then we will come right back." Abraham wasn't saying that to spare them knowledge of what was going to happen. That's not what I believe. I believe Abraham had confidence that God would provide. We see it again. When the boy asks, where's the ram, Dad? Who knows what he knows at this point? He's obviously wondering what's going on. I was standing at the river with my dad looking at that raging water going by, and I'm thinking, where's the bridge? He's wondering, what are we going to sacrifice, Dad? How are we going to do what we're setting out to do today? Abraham confidently says, God will provide a sheep. Abraham was confident in what God was doing to the point where God let it go almost all the way. The boy was bound. Now, Abraham's mighty old, folks. The boy is not. I know my grandson is 1 year old. I was trying to change a diaper on that child last weekend, and I needed 8 hands. I couldn't get that child to lay still for love nor money. I don't know how Abraham managed to bind his son unless his son was a willing participant. God will provide the sacrifice. I think that Abraham's faith in God was transferred to knowledge to his son. I hope. He picked up the knife, and at that moment, the angel called from heaven, "Abraham, Abraham." "Yes, here I am," exclamation point. "Don't lay a hand on the boy," exclamation point. "Don't hurt him in any way." Abraham looked up and saw the ram. God had provided just as Abraham was trusting that God would provide. This is not Abraham hoping. This is Abraham trusting that God would provide. Now, what a happy Father's Day that was, right? Abraham gets to see, first and foremost, he gets to see God act in a miraculous way. He gets to see God come through on something that he trusted was possible. He gets to see God produce a miracle, providing the offering that was needed that day. Second, his one and only son, his cherished child that God had provided him, also gets spared, but doesn't just get spared. Those two together witness that. What a way to bond and forge relationship. Dad and I had so many laughs about me crossing that freezing river and how long it took my skin to turn back to normal color. I think it was days. I was red from here down. But we laughed, and we had joy, and we bonded, and it made us tighter. These two, I think, I hope, this forged something of their relationship that was special. God provided that day. And what a happy Father's Day for our Father. To know that his child, Abraham, whom he had called and he had plans for, Abraham is finally getting it. Abraham is finally making that twist to trusting God in all things. And this is a big thing because, you see, the history of this place and this culture and where Abraham comes from, there is a God for this and there is a God for that and there is a God for this. And they just have people or things that they pray to for everything, but you had to know who it was. Abraham is trusting Yahweh with everything. One God. God will provide. Abraham has made the transition. And our Father in heaven is there with him, seeing that happen. So I think that this is a happy Father's Day on many, many levels. Now for us, as we think about Father's Day and how God has provided for us, we've had communion this morning. We know how God has provided the Lamb for our sacrifice. We know that Christ Jesus went to the cross for us so that we might be saved. It's that this little bit, this chapter has been played out at large through God's love for us, Father, Son, and Spirit. So may we as a church, may we walk together, journeying together with questions. Be willing to ask questions. I love that last week Nancy asked me a question. Ask questions, but trust that God will provide. So may we as a church live that way. Willing to walk together, willing to ask questions, but willing to always trust that God will provide. Our final hymn this morning is How Great Thou Art. Nellie, we're gonna skip the third or the second and go to the third. I love it. Thank you.
Thank you.
of the Father, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of Holy Spirit be with you all now and evermore. Amen.